so much, ladies and gentlemen. So thank you so much for bearing with us this morning. But the presentation we're going to talk to you about is threat assessment and what parents need to know. As I was saying, the school district does have a threat assessment process for students when threats are made. However, I don't know that all of our parents are familiar with that process and what that looks like and, you know, how to move and navigate through it. So we wanted to have this opportunity with parents to discuss that so that we can help answer any questions that may come up in terms of what should be occurring on the school level when threats are made. So our discussion topics today are going to be generic but widespread, hopefully giving you all the information that you need as a starting point. We'll talk about what is a threat. Most parents know what that is, but there are some differences as it relates to our threat assessment process. We're going to cover why are threats made, just because that generally is the starting point of our threat assessment protocol when we're starting to fact find and look for things. We'll look at what types of threats should be reported through our district threat assessment protocol, how to report those threats, and more importantly for parents, what actually happens when those threats are made, because that's generally where I think this presentation will be beneficial for parents to understand what actually happens when something is reported to a school and what schools should be doing when you're reporting those threats to them. So let's just kind of jump in. I always start out with a generic definition of what a threat is, right? And so a threat is a communication, it's a behavior, but it's primarily an individual is basically stating that they are going to harm someone else. And for us, with our threat assessment process, when we look at the term threat, we're looking at a student who's making that threat. And that threat could be to another student, to a staff member, or overall to the school. And so when you think about it, threats are expressed by students and individuals overall, verbally, in writing. You might see a gesture. It could come electronically, like via text, social media, things like that. And so just to give a clear foundation of, you know, what that threat is, we wanted to cover that topic with you first. Before we get into anything, I wanted to share a video. This video is called Evan, and it's from the Sandy Hook Project. And it's really, it's not a lot of talking, but it's really visual to kind of give you an idea of what types of things happen and how things can escalate and the importance of this threat assessment process that we have for the district and why we do it. But also it will help you as a parent either pay attention to your child or something that someone is saying to your child and report it so that we can prevent something from happening. So I'm going to start the video right now. Wait a minute. Gotta go back. It's not showing me the, it's not giving me the audio. Apologize.
Got some news today from the radio man. He spoke the words somber and as softly as he can. The world stood still and the sky opened up. I made my way to fill up my coffee cup. Then it occurred to me as the daylight sky shone blue, today's day that Johnny met June. He waited a while, he knew that he would. He was gonna hang around here for as long as could. The days went by, and hours had passed. He was never sure just how long he would last. But there's not much love in a lonely room. Stay, stay, that Johnny met June.
Have a good summer.
You too. Thanks.
Hey, you must be bored.
No way.
This is the guy that I was running through the library.
Guilty. So you like to write on desks?
Yeah, that's what I do.
Cast on you this place that feels you love underneath our stars the birthday. Oh, how I still love to hear you say. Oh, and everything we ever heard about heaven is true. Today's day that Johnny met you.
All right. I generally start off showing this video. Oops, sorry. I start off showing this video because when we talk about describing what a threat is and what it can be, that video kind of gives most of what we're talking about. There was gestures made, there was social media postings, there were researching weapons online, things like that. All those things were and are important to this presentation for mindset, so that when we're thinking about things that are happening with students that we know are our children, we're mindful of them and reporting them so that action can be taken at the school. So while threats are, oh, my thing is, okay. So while threats are and can be expressed numerous ways, the district threat assessment protocol is used, as I said earlier, for students who make threats to other students, other staff, and the building. And our team gets involved when there are threats made that involve a weapon or mass destruction. Schools still take threats and we still investigate them. But if there's weapons involved, there is a different level of involvement from the school district and school safety, where we have a process to do a little bit more digging and a little bit more research. And so what I wanted to show you was that while threats can be said to other students, they are broken down and there are different levels to it. So what you're seeing on the screen is that there are different types of threats, right? Some kids make threats because they're angry and because they're joking, right? Children are still children. I don't want anybody to think that we're, labeling children as, somebody that's going to engage in mass violence or targeted violence because they said something out of a joke. There is always context of when things are said. And so depending on if it involves a weapon and it arises to that level, what we do is we actually do a deeper investigation to make sure that everybody is safe. So looking on a screen, you'll see that there is a progression. So you have, again, you'll have a threat that could be made as a form of a joke. It could be children exchanging conversation because they're playing video games, and that's the slang and the terminology that they're using in that gaming environment. But then there's also times where there is some conflict, and when it's not addressed, it progresses and it escalates. So now you might have a student that might be scared that is now saying things to bring attention to what is going on so that somebody can take a deeper look at it, where they're really not planning on doing something, but because, something might be getting done to them, they'll say something to back a person away. And so, again, depending on the student, the situation, threats might elevate. Now, if a student is threatening to use a gun or threatening to kill someone and they're sending them texts with pictures of guns and things of that nature, that is obviously on a higher level than somebody that's joking with one another and their friends. All of these different types of things, because schools, we don't always know what they are. We always look at them and we have to take a look at them to make sure. And so we're doing our due diligence through this threat assessment process. Now, many of you may be asking us, why are we presenting this and why are we doing it this way? And, you know, where's it been all these other years? Well, state legislation has actually come down. And because, unfortunately, of just a different, in different states, not necessarily Pennsylvania, but all the different school shootings that have occurred over the years and the increase in mass violence in the country, now the Department of Education is saying that all schools in the state of Pennsylvania must have a threat assessment process and a threat assessment team within their school districts to make sure that when things like this is communicated, that there is a process to investigate, and you need to collaborate across different offices, actually, just to make sure that, you know, we are checking into the threats and making sure that, you know, a student or students are not trying to hurt themselves or anyone else. And so, even though I kind of touched on this in terms of why are threats made, I just want to highlight a couple of points, right? So intimidation, sometimes threats are made because a student is intimidating another student. Another student might be using that as a way of trying to, not necessarily, I don't want to, the word defending themselves is a word and a way to look at it, but I guess I want to change it up a little bit, because I'm going to say, I'm not defending myself when I say something to get you to back away. It's more like protecting my space and getting you to leave me alone if verbal cues are not working. excuse me. It's also a warning sign, again, to a parent, to school staff, when things like this are happening, that something is going on. And so we need to take a broader look at it and dig a little deeper to see what's going on. And in doing that, we're doing that through the threat assessment process. So before I move any further, I do want to take a small pause and see if there are any questions around what I've discussed so far with anybody that's in the audience. Okay. You may not have any right now, but I will also ask that periodically throughout the presentation, and we are leaving time at the end of the presentation if there are any questions from anyone in the audience about what we're talking about. So I'm just going to move forward. So we talked about why threats are made, and this is the reason why threats are made, but we at the school district, we take threats seriously. So even though there may be an explanation, we still need to make sure that the information that is brought to us is looked at and make sure that there are safety precautions put in place if necessary. And so as a parent, I'm going to say, all threats can get reported to their school. Like if something is going on, I'm going to encourage parents to report information to their school, right? But most importantly, sometimes, you know, our child might say something and, you know, then they might say, oh, but we was just playing and stuff like that. And it's not serious. And so you might hear something, you might see something, they give you an explanation about it. And as a parent, it's like, we make the decision. And I get that. What I'm going to encourage though, is that if there's ever any time where you see something written, text that involves a weapon or any type of suggestion that your child or a child your child knows wants to kill themselves or anyone else, I am saying that, please immediately report that to your child's school. There are other options we'll talk about of how you can report it, but most importantly, most parents have a relationship with their schools and their school staff. So I'm going to ask that parents always report this information to the schools, especially if it has something to do with the weapon, especially if you know the student knows someone or is expressing that they want to harm themselves. this should always get reported to the school at a minimum. If there is immediate danger, parents should always call 911 first. And 911 is called because we don't want anyone to harm themselves or to harm anyone else. And if there is immediate danger, the police are the only ones that can act immediately by way of if there needs to be a wellness check. Somebody needs to check on that student in the home because it's immediate. The police are the only ones that actually can go out and do that. So if it is immediate danger, please, please, please call the police first. Now, if you find out this information and it isn't immediate, then you will absolutely want to reach out to your school administrator or your school safety officer. What I will also say is that as a part of the legislation of us having this threat assessment team, another piece of reporting and supporting this process is the Pennsylvania Inspector General's office actually created what is called a Safe to Say hotline. And that Safe to Say hotline is 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The thing too is that if a parent or individual is not sure or wants to remain anonymous, this hotline allows you to remain anonymous. Now, again, there are going to be questions through this hotline process when you call, but they're not asking your name, they're not asking your address and all of those different things, unless it's an imminent thing that you're calling in, which again, what I always ask parents is to call the local police 911 first, because they can actually respond. And if you call the Safe to Say Center, then if it's an imminent danger, they're gonna wanna get that individual helped as well. And so this is actually the campaign. If you had not seen the Safe to Say campaign, this is what it is. Again, with the, and I said the Inspector General, I apologize. I meant to say the Attorney General. This is an anonymous tip line that they have where you can report things. So you can, you know, you can text them, it's confidential, but all of it is to prevent school violence. So that any information that is shared with them, it's in an attempt to prevent something from happening to a child or to a number of children at a school level. You can call, you can text, either way, call or text, you still remain anonymous. But I encourage parents that even so, if something comes to you after hours and you can't get in touch with your administrator or your school safety officer, you may be scared to call 911. So if you're scared to call 911 or you're not comfortable with it, then I'm going to ask you to report using the Safe to Say hotline, a tip line, because that way you're still making everyone aware so that we can prevent any type of targeted school violence. Now, obviously, you want to know how would it work if you call the tip line. So a couple of points here. It still is anonymous. The number is 844 and it's Safe to Say. When you call in the tip line, again, it is anonymous, but there's somebody that's always there in what they call their crisis center, which is a call center, to take the information. That information in an anonymous transmission is sent to school administration. And if it is something that is of an imminent danger, they will reach out to local law enforcement. But in reaching out to them, they will still reach out to the school administration. So school administration is aware that there was a threat. Again, this is anonymous. So it's not something that your name is going to be reported to, your phone number is tracked on. It is an anonymous tip that will say exactly what you tell them, and then it's transmitted. And unless it is imminent danger, it comes to school-based staff. Any questions around what I've said so far? Yeah. Okay. So with no questions, I'm gonna proceed. So what happens when the threat is reported to the school? So obviously we, you know, whether you call the administrator, talk to the school safety officer, excuse me, or if you do it through the safe to say, it still comes back to the school. Information is still shared across, you know, the school district. And so all reports that are made of threats are reported to the district threat assessment team. The district threat assessment team is comprised of school administrator, counselor, the safety officer. There's a threat assessment liaison, and then we have a special education compliance monitor that is on that team for students that have special needs. And so collectively, when a threat is reported, this team comes together and then we look at the information that is presented to the school. And so internally, that process of us looking at all of the information. And so when I say looking at the information that is made available to us, immediately what may be given is not all the information. Like at some point, like we will say, like if it's postings on the internet, we'll try to collect that information so that we could see it. So anything that is about the threat that a student made would get looked at by the school team. One thing is that law enforcement, while we partner with them if it's necessary, they are not brought in unless it is necessary. So if a kid says, for example, I'm gonna shoot you, and it's just a basic statement, like, and a teacher overhears it, the teacher may report it to school staff. This student said, I'm gonna shoot you. Whereas we would meet together to get context. So we're not calling the police because a child said, I'm going to shoot you. We do need to get some context and look into that to see what was the student talking about, what was happening when the student said it. Because again, student could have been getting out of school, had their earbuds on, could have been singing a song. But to just say that the kid said, I'm gonna shoot you with no context, we don't wanna, we're not going to, this is not a penal process. And I think that's the biggest thing and takeaway I want parents to know, that the threat assessment process is not a penal process. It's a proactive process to provide support or to support students or, you know, connect them to any type of resources that may be needed in the event that they need help. It's not to, oh, you said this, now you're going through a threat assessment and you're going to get in trouble. That's not what this threat assessment process is for. And so the team, we look at all this information so that we can determine the seriousness of the threat, meaning like if the kid says, or if a child says, well, oh, that was just, I was reading something that was, or that was, I was reading something on my phone when I said that. Or that was a part of a song that, you know, and people unfortunately say, I'm gonna shoot you in lyrics of songs that we can't necessarily, that we may not necessarily know, because we don't know what the context is. That student might say, oh, that's what I was doing. And so the team, again, talking to the student explaining it, again, it's not penal. It's to make sure that what is being heard or what is said is not taken out of context, but it's also looked at in the event that there is something going on. And so we do that so that we can ensure that there are safety measures in place for a student. If they threaten somebody, for the student that was threatened, we want to make sure that everybody is safe. Now, referrals for students are based on the severity of the threat, right? And so that again comes from the collaboration at the school level, when we get this information and then talking to the parents and bringing the parents in to share those results and what the recommendations are and things of that nature. And we do that because again, you're going to hear me say going forward that this is a proactive preventive process. So if something is going on and a student or a child needs help, as school officials and school staff, we want to help that child. And so that's what this process is designed to do, to make sure that if there is something going on, we are able to work together as a team and support that student. And so with that, I'm going to open it up to questions. We kind of got through a little bit faster than I thought. I kind of wanted to leave in room for questions before and leave in room for questions after. So with that, I don't have anything else on the presentation, but we are here to answer any individual questions that parents may have at this time.
Hello, my name is Tasha Taylor. I am the homeschool president at Edward T. Still Elementary School. And I also have two grandchildren and a son who attends the school. This is helpful information because a lot of times you don't get to hear about these procedures in depth. And I was wondering if you guys come out to speak to the parents.
We are beginning to do that. That's a part of our plan of outreach and awareness. And so right now we're working with the FACE office to make this information available. But if there is something that maybe in the upcoming school year,
right,
especially when we're starting back up, if there's opportunities, we generally try to keep it so that it's fair across mm-hmm. the board. But if there's something that you would be interested in talking to us further about, please, you can always call our office. I know I took the PowerPoint down. I'm sorry, but you can always call us at our office, the 415-447-1010, and you can ask to speak to myself or Lisa Blake. And I'm probably going to drive you to Lisa Blake first because I'm always out of the office moving around, and I don't want you to think that I gave you a number and you can't connect with anybody.
Right. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Mm-hmm. Anybody else have any questions about the process? Anything about Safe to Say that anybody wants to know about that is an anonymous reporting tip line, which I absolutely, want to encourage parents to utilize, especially for things that happen after hours when schools are actually closed. Because, if it is an emergency, we don't want to wait hours until schools open up to get that information.
I got a question in the chat to me directly. When the police is called, what exactly do they do? What's the process that the police follows? This person has a friend that has a really rebellious child, and they've called the police before. They feel like maybe nothing's been done with the police, so they're kind of curious about what the process the police follows when this happens.
So it depends on, it's going to depend on what the threat is, right? So this process is around students making threats. So I want to make sure I answer the question. And so if a student makes a threat and the threat is reported directly to 911, I can't say what their process is going to be other than them coming out to the home, looking and seeing, what's going on with the child and making a determination with the parent whether or not that child might need to be seen at the hospital to get some additional support. It could be another reason, some things going on. I can't speak to that process outside of the school district. For us, if we have to notify the police, we're notifying the police because we've been made aware of a threat that is life-threatening. So if they come to a home from us contacting them, they are doing what is called a wellness check. And in that wellness check, they're making sure that individual student is safe for one. First thing is life safety, and that that student is safe. And again, based off of what is reported, if it was reported to be weapons, then police will talk to the parent to say, hey, this is what was reported to us. You know, is this accurate? Is your child okay? Like, and so they will talk to the family. They're not coming to make any arrests. And so I want to be clear, you know, when law enforcement works with us, it's not about coming to the home and arresting anyone. It is about making sure that that individual child is safe, and that the threat that was reported is not of an imminent danger to that child or anybody else. And so that's what it's for. And if a child is having some behaviors, then, you know, from a school standpoint, the school might say to the family, hey, we might need to, maybe we can take the child and get them seen by the doctor. You know, there might be some behavioral or some psychological things going on. And those would be what we call like referrals that are collectively made. But as far as the police, from our perspective, they're coming out to make sure that the child is okay, the child is safe, and that there's no imminent danger of that threat actually happening. What they do when you call them on your own for a behavior, I can't really speak to that. So I hope I answered your question just a little bit, if not totally.
They are satisfied with that answer.
Okay. Are there any other questions?